All right, we continue our Tisha B'Av marathon here with some incredible non-dual realizations and considerations here. This one's very, very, very important. Okay, the last one I talked about, peace. Okay, we went over the whole issue of that what we're trying to do is really establish a lack of peace first, so then we can then bring peace. There is no lack of peace anywhere. Now, along those lines, there's another issue, and that is we've established this imaginary decree that only peacemakers get into heaven. Only those who will heal and to bring peace. You know, you have to do good to get into heaven. You have to do good to get into heaven, okay? We have this. But what we're saying here is that there is no lack of peace, ever. There is no sickness. There is no lack of health of reality, ever. There is no lack of abundance, ever. There isn't anything wrong. There is no lack with God's creation whatsoever, none. So if that's the case, how can we be do-gooders, actually? And how can we get into heaven as we think, well, the answer is we never left heaven. We don't need to get into heaven. There's only heaven. There's nowhere else to go. The whole idea of saying that we need to get into heaven implies there's someplace else other than heaven. You see how dualistic that is? There isn't any place other than heaven. This is it. It's all it. There's only heaven. There's only reality. There's no other place. There's only God's creation. There's no other place other than that. And so the I is kind of this idea of like, wait, I got to get back into heaven. I got to get to heaven. So I need to do good. I need to bring peace where there's conflict. And then God will say, ah, you're a peacemaker. Good. You can come into heaven. And then when we hear there is no such thing as a lack of peace anywhere, we start panicking and say, well, how can I get into heaven then? How can I get into heaven? Amazing how these dualistic concepts, isn't it, just wreak havoc with us, and how fearful we become, how fearful we feel. And how this unexamined, this has all been unexamined territory here, and then going into this territory, we say, hey, wow, wait a minute, wow. This is a new light here, a new light. I need to accomplish something in order to get into heaven. I need to do something good. I need to be, in order to get into heaven. And now we're hearing there's nothing, no good you can ever do. There isn't any good you can do. There's nothing wrong anywhere. Everything's perfect. What good can you do? it's like, wow. Of course, we don't need to get into heaven. We're already there. Everyone's already there. Everyone's already there. Now, is helping reassure everyone that this is true, is that doing good? Well, it doesn't get you into heaven. You're already there. It's just an expression of joy, I guess. If it's joyful, expression of joyful to reassure others, then fine, that's its own reward. But it's not attaining anything. You're not getting closer to God. You're not moving up the spiritual hierarchy. No, everything's already perfect. Everyone's already in heaven. There's nothing wrong at all. There's nothing to fix, nothing to change, nothing to fix. No problems anywhere. No problems whatsoever. So, this is a very profound block that the world has. We haven't realized this is dualism. This is the belief that doing good, that's completely dualistic. It's really an attack on God. It's really an attack on God. To say that I need to do good is to say there's something about creation that's not perfect, which is an attack on God. To say that I need to bring peace is an attack on God. It's saying there's a lack of peace somewhere. Something's wrong with your creation, God. It's not true. It's not a little attack. It represents a desire to attack God. through pretending to be helping God, you see, is helping to hurt. So the non-dualistic perspective is one that's not often heard here. It's not often heard. It tends to panic us because we think we're somewhere else and we need to get somewhere. And we got to earn our way, you know, earn our way. It's, you know, you hear about the difference between salvation through works and salvation through grace. Which is true? Well, salvation through grace is true. There's no works that need to be done. Because to say that there's works that need to be done is to deny the perfection of God. And it's to assert that there's some other condition, some other place, some other will, you see, there's not. Grace simply means you're already there, never left. The grace of realization, the only grace there really is the grace of realization, of realizing where we are. We're imagining we're somewhere else. We're imagining we're someplace that there's lack. So salvation is through grace. Works is dualistic entirely, entirely. And it's important to just take this in and don't try to extrapolate it. Don't go forward, don't go back, don't go side. Just take it in just as it is and just abide with that. Don't start thinking about all sorts of questions. Now, wait a minute, this. No. It loses its potency to of realization if you do that. So we're afraid that if we see that the world is perfect, we have no chance of earning our way to heaven here. It's like, oh my gosh, I gotta leave here. There's no opportunity for me here, how terrible. It's the same reason why we're afraid of the death-free realms, which also are, it's an illusion, so to speak, but there are realms where there's no evidence of impermanence or death or decay or sickness or anything like that. If we find ourselves there, we'll say, there's no way to earn, everything's perfect here. There's no way to earn my way into heaven here. You know, there's nothing to fix. I need to go someplace where people are sick so I can treat them. I want to be a doctor somewhere. I want to cure these sick people. I want to be a diplomat. I want to come in and I want to bring peace. You know, I want to be a charity worker and bring food. I want to do this and this and that. I want to earn my way. There's no way to earn my way here. So if we believe we need to earn our way into heaven, what happens? We imagine all these realms, hellish realms, right? Where there's just like, wow, if I go down there, that's really terrible and dark. I'd really be able to earn a lot of points there. If I can do a lot, there's a lot of good I can do down there. So I'm gonna go there, kind of thing. So we've just conjured up this massive dream where we think we can earn our way to heaven. We never left heaven. There's no place other than heaven. It's impossible to earn your way to heaven because there's no other place, no other place to be in the first place. And secondly, everything's perfect. So how can you fix anything? There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to fix. And so those who cannot recognize this, you know, flee into this dream of layers and levels, searching for opportunities. And if they were to be in a place that was perfect, they'd freak out and say, I'll never be able to, you know, help. There's nothing needs to be helped here. I never this is terrible for me. This is like hell. This is blocking me from heaven. This is blocking me. So they look at heaven as if heaven's blocking them from heaven. See, they look at God as if God's blocking them from God. Because heaven's perfect. They say, I can't earn my way to heaven in perfection. So they turn their backs on heaven, turn their backs on God, and look at this dream, this imaginary scenario, and say, this is where I can do my work. This is where I must abide. Here I can elevate myself through good works. All the while, the whole time, they already are in heaven. No one's ever left. There's nowhere else to go. They're just ignoring this fact and putting their attention on a dream, hallucination, really. Everybody comes here, almost everyone comes here, agrees that they too need to work their way to heaven. That agreement's okay. I'll be sick and you help me. And then next time you'll be sick and I'll help you. So there's all these agreements going on here. This time you victimize me and I'll feel superior to you. Next time I'll victimize you and I'll feel superior to you. But both times will establish that there is threat here, you see. You victimize me, that'll establish that there's threat. And then I'll help you establish that there's threat next time. There's all these agreements going on beneath the surface in mind about the actions in play here in this world. And so there's all these acting this out to try and establish the baseline of lack, of vulnerability, of so they can then fix it. Oh, there's this terrible victimizer. Okay, let's get him and put him in jail and execute him. Okay, we've helped solve that problem to some extent. You see, we did some good. We got rid of the danger. See, there's danger, but the whole thing is rigged behind the scenes. It's all a cooperative play, actually. Everything here is a cooperation, a play, trying to establish a baseline of lack in reality, lack of security, lack of peace, lack of well-being, lack of happiness, lack. So they want to first establish that and then work on fixing it, which is the game of trying to be greater than God. It's all cooperative, this whole thing. All actors and actresses here, pretending everything is happening to them, like without any cooperation. Of course, if it was all cooperative, we'd say, well, hey, wait a minute. It looks like we're just trying to force the issue and try to come up with this issue. But they're saying, no, this stuff just happens on its own. We're not trying to do anything. It just proves this is the way reality is. You see, we're just being affected by reality. This is, and so we refuse to see it's all cooperative, which is why people cannot see into the future. I used to be able to see into the future very clearly. And I'd say, oh, here comes somebody, and they're coming to bother you because you wanted them to, and I could see what's going to happen because I could see the cooperation. At the level of cooperation, what's going on? And they would insist, no. I didn't have any agreement with anybody. You're crazy. And then what happens? They said, I have no knowledge about this. It's impossible. You can't know. So nobody likes that. Because the cat's out of the bag, spilling the beans of the cooperativeness of all this. It's all rigged. It's all rigged here. It's all a setup. So it is entirely possible to see into the future. I used to be able to see into it beautifully. But the world hates it so much. I've not been able to do that so much as I've gotten more and more years in this world. It's just the pressure is people, that's the one thing they can't stand, because the whole game would be pretty much up if you see that. And you say, oh, here comes your antagonist. He's coming in to bully you. And if you tell them, then they have to give an excuse why they didn't take evasive measures or something, right? Whereas in fact, is they want the bully to become, there's an agreement between the two. So they get bullied, and they can just then establish the fact that reality is unsafe, unfriendly, right? So if you tell them what's coming, then they don't do anything about it, then you can say, hey, I told you, and you didn't do anything about it. You must be in cahoots here, right? And see, that's what they don't want. The whole scheme, you know, is up in smoke at that point. So I've had a hard time being able to see what's going to happen in the future because of this, but I guarantee you that the future is absolutely clear to those who are perfectly aware of what's going on here. They can look and see the future, absolutely. Now, there may be shifts of intention and et cetera that take place. So I don't know how perfectly accurate. I guess it is possible to be flawlessly accurate. So the future is an open book because it's all intentions. It's all agreements. That's in the mind. It's all in the mind. It's all in the mind. Everything that's happening. And the agreements often take place way before the event actually happens, because they want to have a long period of time, sometimes a gap, so it seems very unlikely that this thing could have been set up ahead of time. You know, they're trying to give it a delay, as if a delay sort of means that the intention is not really there. You know, time means it never really took place, the intention. So there may be gaps of quite some time before then the event that they agreed upon, they actually acted out here in this world. I saw that there's usually a gap of a couple days. In normal life, there's a lag here between the level of agreeing to act out everything here, where we're all structuring all what's happening here, and then the actual acting out in this world is usually a couple days lag. That's what I was able to determine. Now, there's some bigger issues here. Have a longer lag to them. And so you might be aware of intention and agreement that's taking place that's going to happen, and then you're not sure when it's going to happen. It might be 2 years later, or even longer. That's why you can even predict thousands of years in advance. You can know what the big meta agreements are, and there's an agreement that we're going to, at some time in the future, maybe a couple thousand years, we're going to bring about this big, you know, situation. And then you can say, this is what the intentions are. Because if you're just making an agreement with someone else, hey, I want you to cause me problems, and I will agree to act out that I'm having problems, so that we can both establish the principle that there are problems in reality. And if you see it's just two actors, actresses, doing this intentionally in order to give the appearance of something which isn't true, then you're going to say, whoa, wait a minute, this is bogus, what's going on. So this world, you know, is fanatical about saying you cannot see the future, fanatical about it. And my early life was totally lived with constant awareness of the future, of intentions, what was going to happen. So I knew they were lying, absolutely, the world is absolutely lying about this, and is very defensive about it, because of their continuity fear, for sure. So I stopped telling people about it. I stopped telling people what's going to happen, and tried to, you know, prevent this awareness in myself, because people got too upset. And they would still get very upset. So I've not been able to pinpoint things like I used to, and it's very much, I'm very much out of that mode of predicting or telling people, because it's better to work on the overall clarity about the whole situation. It's much, much better. Because people will, even if you predict something, people will blame, they'll always pin the blame on some other people. Okay, they did this, they conspired to this. And they fail to see that everyone, all of existence is a conspiracy. It's all a conspiracy. The whole thing is a conspiracy. It's conspiring against God, trying to change reality under the idea that somehow we have to fix reality in order to be welcomed back in reality, which is a false premise that we ever left it, right? There's all these false premises. We left reality. Reality is not what it really is. We have the ability to fix it, and therefore we have the ability to return. All four false premises right there. And by the way, I woke up this morning. It seems like every morning I wake up at 4:44 I get woken up. Man, it's terrible. 4:44 four false premises. It seems like there's four basic false premises about duality, right? The idea that you can leave heaven, you know, leave reality. There's something wrong with reality. You can fix it, and then you can go back. The four false premises. We'll see. We'll see how this is going. We'll see if I'm on track here. I believe certainly I'm on track here. It's just you don't hear this type of talk very often in the world because, again, the pressure. People don't want this conspiracy to be seen because from their standpoint, that's like God attacking them. They think they got to do good to get back to heaven. Refusing to admit they never left. Refusing to admit the whole scheme is actually to try to attempt to be greater than God, you see? That's the thing that people are not admitting. Once you admit that to God, you're on the same page, then you don't really have the same feeling of concern about truth. You welcome truth. You're welcoming. So, great. Okay, God, thanks for pointing that out to me. That's wonderful. I really appreciate it. I see, you know, you feel that way. You feel you're eager to recognize your mistakes. You're eager to recognize your false premises. You're eager to see through duality. You love it. You know, this is great. Repent. I don't have any, you know, a peace problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a peace problem. I have a continuity problem. And, you know, you can tell in your own self if this just like sinks in and you just say like, ah, that's a nice meal, I like that. I'm not trying to throw it up, I'm not trying to regurgitate it, right? See, it's like eating food. You eat some food, let it settle, let it digest it. Okay? Instead of trying to throw it up, don't gag yourself, try to throw it up, regurgitate. Which is what the mind, once the intellect gets on it, is trying to gag you and regurgitate it, right? Oh. God, throw that up. That's not good for you. How are we going to get into heaven? How are we going to get into heaven? First, to start out, how are we going to get out of heaven? But we hit it very cleverly by saying, oh, no, we're just trying to get into heaven. No, we're trying to get out of it, actually. We're trying to get out of it. Of course, when we say, hey, God, I really want to earn my way back into heaven, we are saying, what's the meta message of that? The underlying meta message, we're not in heaven. And God, I'm really suffering. I need to make things better. I'm suffering a lack. And can you help me? Well, that's basically saying there is a lack in heaven, in reality. So we're continuously supporting false premises in so many different ways and thinking we're being very clever about it. But once you see that it's really not that clever at all, then you say, wow, I'm not fooled by this at all. God can't possibly be fooled by this either. You know. Well, today is a marathon for sure. Day of doom. Day of tragedy, very likely to be spearheading what the world, the grand conspiracy that existence is. Existence is just a grand conspiracy that we're all acting out these roles to augment this conspiracy to make it seem more plausible. Okay, Now, if you ask, well, how can I escape all this suffering? I said, well, you don't have to keep acting out this grand conspiracy to try to make it seem plausible that there is suffering and that you need to fix suffering. We're only pretending. Remember, everything we're feeling is a pretense. We're pretending. We're pretending to die. We're pretending to suffer. We're pretending to be sick. We're not really sick. We're not really dying. There's really no lack at all. But we're pretending in our imagination. We're dreaming it, actually. And the realization will come, we've never been sick. We never died. We were never born. We never entered into any place other than heaven. We never left heaven. There's never been any lack. We never even fell asleep. We've been consciously dreaming the whole time, actually. The whole idea we need to wake up is also false. We're consciously conspiring against God, actually. And we say, no, I fell asleep, I'm dreaming, I have no idea. No, that's not true. We're still wide awake. We're actually awake. We're pretending this is all a dream. We're sleeping as if we're asleep. We don't know what we're doing. Yes, we do. Again, we don't need to keep trying to fool God. I say, God, I'm in full awareness and consciousness, God. I have been trying to find a way to be greater than you, you see. And now I'm seeing all of everything I've done to do that. So it's not like we're in this some comatose state, really. Or the comatoseness is the continuity fear, okay, but that is true. We are, but the other part is not. We're fully aware of everything we're doing and just trying to say that we entered into some other state, a dream state, a sleeping state. There's no other state. We can't enter into any other state than reality. There isn't any other state, actually. We're just pretending. Pretending to be asleep. We're not really asleep. Pretending to be dreaming. We're not really dreaming. We're conspiring. We're conspiring for sure. Absolutely, we're conspiring. Conspiring a hypothetical scenario of plausibility. So I would assume that a completely realized teacher would bring additional clarifications, you know, and just this is not far off, though, you know. I don't feel it's far afield at all from what would be said by anyone, really. There are different ways to emphasize. But most of the principles are here. You know, I'm trying to bring it even greater, like saying we're not even dreaming, actually. We're actually wide awake. We never went to sleep. That too is a lie. That too is a... How can awareness go to sleep? It's impossible. It's impossible. We have to know we're dreaming. We're using it as an excuse. I don't know what I'm doing. You see, I'm in a dream. I'm dreaming. I don't know what I'm doing. It's not true either. So I just keep bringing all this up, I hope some realized being will be here. And we can then feel like, hey, yeah, let this sink in and really accept it more and more and more and more and more. That's my prayer for sure. Now, of course, if there's a realized being sitting here, we might be nervous. You know, I always thought, wow, nervous. Well, we're nervous because we think they may see through our lies, you know, and our pretenses. And we say, uh-oh, I'm about to get caught with my hand in the cooking jar here. But if you just admit to it, you're open to it, then, you know, you don't feel so frightened. So this is what we're doing here. This is what we're doing here. In a way, there's some distance here. You know, you're not in the same place here, and you can stop the video whenever you want, stop watching, whatever. Where's this enlightened, realized being right with you, right there? You know, you'd have to get away from them to think that you're getting away from them. And how do you stop what's going on? No, they're right here. You can't, you know, it's not like a video you can stop. So it's like, wow, you know, you're on the spot right there. And so that's tough for sure. Whereas if you really confess, you really repent, and what we're doing is repenting, repent, 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 confess, confess, confess. See, it's all a grand conspiracy. It's all intentional, God. There's no hypnosis, no sleep. It's not unintentional. It didn't just happen. That's all nonsense. You know, I take 100% responsibility for it entirely. It was a completely conscious, intentional attempt to be greater than you, God, and to essentially attack you and change reality and all this conspiracy, trying to pretend like there's something wrong with reality and then I can fix it, and be playing nice like, no, I'm just trying to get back into heaven. And all this stuff was a scheme, a conspiracy, a scam, 100%. If you, you know, just do that, then a realized being, you know, I don't feel like there's anxiety or fear, like, because you've already, you know, confessed to God, right? And of course, God says, yeah, that's right. Now you're getting it. Good, 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 good. That's great. That's great. I don't know if there's some other deep, dark secret to bring up. I don't know what it could be. I've said everything's a conspiracy here. We're trying to trick God, trying to deceive God through all this conspiracy of agreements and then insisting that these aren't agreements, that somehow God is causing these problems for us, these lacks, these miseries, these sufferings, these apparent lack of peace, all these lacks, that somehow God's creation is, this is the way it is, and not that we're just pretending that this is happening to us, you know. This, you know, that's major confession. It's very important. So trying to pave the road here, pave the road. The more we can do this, the better you'll feel, for sure. It's a huge burden off your shoulders, right? Because God doesn't strike you down. You're not, God says, oh, it's terrible. You admitted that you're trying to do this. I had no idea. Now I'm really going to punish you. Now God knew this from the very beginning. It's completely obvious and transparent. God said, there's nothing wrong with the kingdom. Everything's perfect, and you're perfect too. So I just want you to realize that, that's all. And stop trying to, you know, you don't have to keep trying to pretend there's something is not right in order to try and earn your way back, because that's actually an attempt to be greater than God. You know, and the only demand is that you be as you were created to be, that's all. And which is perfect, which is totally free. And so, Without a doubt, I feel less worried about, like, if there's a realized being here today, I feel less scared for sure after this marathon today. Cleared up a lot of stuff. The whole idea of remoteness, indifference, high indifference, they're not doing anything about the world, you know, the peace, they're not trying to bring peace at all, you know. On and on and on. They can see the future, of course they can. They can see intentions, of course, and all this. Then it's like, I think at some point we have to try. I don't know what the response would be. I can't. But it certainly feels less fearful now. Way less fearful. Yeah, way less fearful. There's no jitters. I'm not feeling jitters or reactions or anything. Okay, so this is very good. And we'll see if we can keep the marathon going. Okay, that's it.